Quai des Polars.
Quai du Polar.
Quai du Polar.
Quai du Polar.
Quai du Polar.
There are two people in the Appalachian Mountains. It's a contemporary. Becky, as a child, was involved in a school shooting and has been traumatized by that, even to the point of muteness. But by working back through nature, she has recreated a language that has enabled her and a sensitivity to survive. Les is a man who has had a wife with depression. He did not understand it, and because of that, he caused a near tragedy. So both of these people are carrying burdens, and Becky also spoke when she wasn't supposed to. So in a sense, they've both broken vows not to speak or to, you know, to be supportive. And so the novel is about these two very different people who have chosen two paths. One has to search for the light to survive. Les goes into the darkness because in a way it almost, he hopes it will absolve him of that if the world is this terrible, then, you know, what I did is just part of the world. But he and Becky, I think, run counter. And I thought that would be an interesting premise because they are, in their own way, attracted to each other. But they recognize their aloneness. Becky is working in an active voice. She's so engaged in the world that she's, in a sense, searching almost to be like the animals, to be in a kind of eternal present, because of the burden of time, the burden of the past that she carries. So she has this intense engagement with everything, very active. Les is more reflective, more passive, I would say, in a sense. You know, he's trying to kind of just be, accept his life as it is, though a scene in the book when he has to go into the trailer will change that. So they are both working on different levels. And one thing I really wanted to do in this novel is attempt to really engage two dichotomies, you know, present tense, past tense, male, female, striving for light, striving for darkness. And Simone Weil, I always mispronounce this, the philosopher once said that contradiction is the lever of transcendence. And my hope would be that these juxtapositions are building towards something that the reader will feel, I hope, almost sublime. You know, so the reader will have to decide whether I do that, but I was trying for that. The book works on, I hope, a number of levels. And certainly one level is social commentary about the idea of who owns the natural world or can it be owned. Unfortunately, in the United States, we see this often, and people who have lived in particular places, sometimes for generations, will suddenly be a kind of way of life where people shared the natural world is ended, and that's seen as a direct affront, particularly to someone as old as Gerald is in the novel. So we get into the plot where Gerald runs into a conflict. Ultimately, that leads to the fact that he may be convicted of a very serious crime that will essentially end his life. Well, I think real good literature is always a war against cliche. But I think particularly right now, what I see that's most disturbing in the United States, and it's reminiscent of what George Orwell feared, is the complete breakdown of meaning. When Trump speaks, he speaks in such contradictions that he has, I think, kind of destroyed that whole idea of any kind of real communication. But what I wanted to do with Becky's voice, I wanted her to really kind of begin again, you know, at the very basis of language and build her own language, but a language that's so connected to the natural world that it closes that gap that language sometimes, particularly contemporary language in the United States, is just kind of lost between thing, I and thou, you know, the thing and the thing objective. And we always know we can't quite get there, but Becky is striving, and I think there are moments when she comes very close.